How are you doing on your scripture memorization? You know, Ken and I last week just encouraged you, and we just said, you know, let's follow in Pastor Paul's legacy and let's memorize scripture together this year. And so we encouraged you to memorize one scripture every month that we give you, which is this one here, Deuteronomy. By the way, we picked Deuteronomy because Deuteronomy was my dad's favorite book of the Bible. Don't know if you knew that or not, but that's why we picked Deuteronomy. So one scripture that we give you a month and one scripture that you ask God to give you a month. And every month, we as a church corporately are memorizing at least two scriptures a month. Some of us can do more than that, but let's just commit together, like we talked about last week. We are committing together to know the Word of God. Because God can't bring to your memory in times of crisis what you have not already put there. Amen, amen. Okay, turn with me, if you would, to Romans chapter 15, and it's going to take me a really long time to get there, but I will get there eventually. But before I begin, I just want to give you another brief admonition, something that I have been thinking a lot about. But Philippians 4:8 is a scripture that my parents made me memorize as a young child. I put the emphasis on made me, probably because they knew I needed it. But it says this: finally, brethren, whatever is true, whatever is honorable, whatever is right, whatever is pure. Look at all these adjectives it gives. Whatever is lovely, whatever is of good repute, of good reputation. If there is any excellence and anything worthy of praise, dwell on these things. Here, quite literally, God tells us what to think about. Does he not? And if you're anything like me, it is easier for me to think about negative things, to think about problems, to think about injustices, to think about hurts. But here in this verse, God tells me to take control of my thinking. You know, the same thing is said in 2 Corinthians 10:5, tells us to take every thought captive. In other words, take negative thoughts and put them in prison. That's my very loose translation. Take every thought captive to the obedience of Christ. And again, control your thinking. Well, how does this apply to me recently? And I'm going to be pretty real and pretty raw here, so bear with me. But my dad, as you know, died about 43 days ago, something like that. And he died at a very hard time of year. He died at Christmas. And his death was very sudden and very unexpected. And forgive me if you feel like I'm talking about my dad too much, but I always get up here and try to talk to you about what God has been saying to me, and everything that God is saying to me right now revolves around my dad. Because it was such a huge loss for me and for many of you. But I was just pondering recently, and again, I'm just being very real here, but dealing with the death of a loved one that's so very precious to you at Christmas time is not easy. It's hard. And many of you know this, but we had to bury my dad. He received a military burial, full honors. He was drafted into the Korean War. We buried my dad when the military told us to bury my dad. They give you a time and a day, and you show up, and it is what it is. But that day happened to be my parents' 55th wedding anniversary. That was December 23rd. And for as long as I can remember, December 23rd was a day that we celebrated as a family. My parents never did, because it was so Christmas time, always Christmas time, they would celebrate their anniversary together in the summer. But all of us children, would gather on December 23rd, and then we would bring our boyfriends, and then it became our spouses, and then all of the grandchildren and all the big crew of us would gather year after year after year on December 23rd to celebrate their anniversary together. We had plans to do that again this year, but this year, we had to bury my dad on the actual day. And I'm just being real, but you know what? I thought I can focus on, God, what were you thinking? That's tough. Losing him at Christmas time was horrific. Having to bury him on their wedding anniversary, their 55th wedding anniversary, almost felt cruel, heartless. Where's mercy? God, you determine a man's days. Was there not an easier time, an easier path, an easier season? And you know what? I just talk to God like he's my best friend because he is. And I would encourage you to talk to God that way too. I don't hide your emotions and your questions and your doubts from him. He knows them anyway. I'm not saying blame God or get wrapped up in the whys of life. I'm just saying be real. Be real. So I was real with God and just asking him about it. And the Holy Spirit is so faithful to me and to us. And he began to speak to me, and he revealed some things to me. My dad died on my sister's very first day of Christmas vacation. She's a teacher. She's a very dedicated teacher. Taking off time for school would be really difficult for her, and she would have been really torn about that. But he died on the first day of her Christmas vacation, so she had all of then Christmas vacation to help us walk through as a family, to walk through this together. You know, we actually, my sister and I went and bought Christmas presents for my dad the day he died, that morning. He died that night. Returning those Christmas presents to the store was not easy, as you can imagine. But my sister didn't have to take time off from work because she was already off. My sons, my two older sons, are both dedicated students in college. My oldest son, brag on him a little bit, he is a straight-A student at one of the hardest business schools in the nation. One of the most prestigious, and you don't know this necessarily, but CU Business School, the Leeds Business School, is one of the most prestigious business schools in the whole nation. He's a serious student. My other son is at CSU. He's majoring in engineering. I can't imagine if they had had to come home with Grandpa dying and have to go back to school to take finals, but they finished final exams right before Grandpa died. And so they were able to come home and just be with us as a family and not have to worry about school. And then I've told you this before, but my two younger sons were with Grandpa about an hour before he collapsed. They went every Friday night to his house, my grandma and grandpa's house. Grandpa went out that night just like normal and bought him food. Came back, they ate together. Caleb and Nate left to come to youth group, and Grandpa collapsed. And I will forever be grateful to Almighty God that they did not have to see Grandpa collapse. That would be a horrible trauma to remember. And God intervened in the timing in that. I had a friend who I called that night frantically. She, I think, was already in bed. She told me she had her pajamas on, and I said, can you go to church and pick up my two guys? They're at youth group, and say something to them about why Ken and I aren't picking up. And she drove to church and graciously and kindly and somewhat evasively told the boys why she was picking them up and why we weren't picking them up. And it just, like, she just was able to cover them with just a sense of safety and a sense of protection. And so, you know what? For me, it all comes down to this. I can focus on the horrible timing of my dad's death, or I can focus on God's goodness of the timing in my dad's death. I can count my woes, or I can count my blessings. I can focus on how my dad died at Christmas time, or I can focus on the fact that my kids and my sister and my whole family were available and unhindered by different commitments. Finally, brethren, whatever's true, whatever's honorable, whatever's right, whatever's pure, whatever's lovely, whatever's of good repute, if there is anything of excellence and anything worthy of praise, dwell on these things. But you know what? It's a choice. It's a choice we have of what we're going to dwell on. And my conclusion in this whole experience is simply this. It almost seems like God knows what he's doing. It almost seems that way. He's in charge of time. He counts a man's days, and he works it out. I was really low at one particular point in this season. And you know what? I was thinking about that song that we sang today, You Make Me Brave. And you know, truthfully, grief comes in waves. If you've lost someone very close to you, grief comes in waves. But the song we sang today talked about, When You Make Me Brave, talks about his love comes in waves. His love comes in waves too. And then I'm just gonna keep wading in the water and letting God's love just wash over me. And even though I miss my dad, and even though he was such a rock to Ken and I and a rock in this church, God's gonna make us brave. right? And we're going to walk through this season, and we're going to carry on my dad's legacy by learning and knowing Scripture, and we're going to say, great is our God, and we're going to worship him in the good times and the bad. I was at a really low point, and Ben's girlfriend, Rachel, said, you need to listen to this song, and she sent me the link, and it was a song by Jason Crabb that says, God, he knows what he's doing. I encourage you to listen to that song if you get a chance. God, he knows what he's doing. There's an old hymn that says, when upon life's billows you are tempest tossed, when you are discouraged, thinking all is lost, count your many blessings, name them one by one, and it will surprise you what the Lord has done. And I'm going to believe the Lord for his goodness in the land of the living. Let me give you some tweets. This is a good one. The Bible is the only book where the author is always present when you read it. Many books transform you, but many books inform you, but there is only one book that will transform you. Ken showed me the title to this book here recently. It made me laugh. It said this: if my husband would change, I would be happy. And other Ms. Wise belief. A bad marriage is hard. Building a good marriage is hard. Choose your hard. Ouch. Cough through rough though. None of these words rhyme, but by their spelling, doesn't it seem like they should? But for some reason, pony and baloney rhyme. English is weird. None of the workers requested more tools. They didn't ask for a shovel, a better headlight, a sharper pick, a map. No one was trying to dig their way out of this mess. Without help from above, there was no hope. 33 miners were trapped 2,000 feet below the surface of the earth in Chile. Trapped in a mine nearly half a mile underground. And at first, the men didn't know the extent or the cause of the damage. They believed that they would be rescued in a few hours, if not a few days. And so they retreated to a place called the Refuge, which was a classroom-sized steel-enforced safe room that held provisions, survival provisions, for 25 men for 2 days. And you're familiar with the story. They weren't there for 2 days, but for 2 months. The inventory of the food in the refuge included 1 can of salmon, 1 can of peaches, 1 can of peas, 18 cans of tuna, 24 liters of condensed milk, 8 of which were spoiled, 93 packages of cookies, not counting the few that some of the men had stolen, and 10 bottles of water. As time went on and the rescue efforts, they didn't know if rescue efforts were going on. It was just dark and quiet. One man became a leader, and he would line up 33 little plastic cups in rows, and he would teaspoon 1 teaspoon of canned tuna into each cup and then pour over some water to make it like a broth. And along with this, he handed each man 2 cookies, and as he was reported as saying to them, enjoy your meal, this is delicious stuff, make it last. Because for each day, this was all the food they got. Day after day after day passed. They formed a society. They held daily prayer meetings. They exercised together. They created their own board and made checkers and played checkers together. And all the while, they held out hope that someone from up there would come and find a way into their world down here and help them and rescue them and save them. Meanwhile, rescuers from above were devising a plan, calling upon NASA, calling in experts. The Chilean government was determined to rescue these men. The pressure was mounting because the world was watching. But the Chilean media reported that those men had a less than 2% chance of survival. But on day 17 days in, more than 2 weeks, the men heard this whoosh of air from above, and the drill had come through and found them. And the drill created a 4.5-inch hole. And it says the men were rejoicing so much that they handed around a water bottle of dirty water, handing it around like it was a glass of champagne, rejoicing, celebrating. And food and clean water were passed through that 4.5-inch hole. Here is a picture of the president of Chile holding a note that had been sent from below. It's in Spanish, but in English it says, "We're fine in the refuge, the 33. The world above learned that all 33 were alive. And hope was reborn for the miners stuck below, for the families who had set up a residence outside near the mine, and they called the residence where they all gathered, they called it Camp Hope. The miners were actually able to talk on the phone to their loved ones above. They had dropped down a phone line. And everyone was rejoicing until the experts informed them that getting those men to the surface could take months, and it might never happen. The families were devastated. Hope crashed. And the men down below realized they might be living in their own graves. Jose Enrique was a man who became known as the pastor. He requested that 33 Bibles be lowered into the cavern because he was leading a daily Bible study. I would imagine that the attendance was very high. Because no man had ever lived so far below the surface of the earth for so long and lived to tell about it. 40 days into their entrapment, one of the miners' wives went into labor. She was pregnant. And the husband had promised his wife, "I will be there when you give birth," but he couldn't be. But with modern technology, he was able to watch the birth live on video. And he named his new daughter Esperanza, which means hope. Finally, on October 13th, 2010, on the 69th day of their captivity, the rescuers successfully lowered a 13-foot tall capsule called the Phoenix. And one by one by one by one, the miners began to merge. At 4:04 a.m., Florencio Avalo exited first, a 31-year-old father who is greeted by his family and then hugged here in this picture by the president of Chile and the first lady of Chile. A 40-year-old miner exited second. You remember him. He burst forth from the capsule, yelling and giving everybody high fives and creating and just all these victory chants, and he just stirred everybody up. Then came a great-grandfather. Then a 44-year-old who was planning a church wedding, then a 19-year-old. Every rescue was a victory. Every rescue was hope fulfilled. Yanni Barrios was a man who became known as the doctor down low. He had some doctoring to do when he got to the top, because not one but two women were waiting for him. The first was his wife of 31 years. The second was his mistress. The first didn't know about the second. She found out about the second when they both planted their flags at Camp Hope, claiming him as their spouse. That love triangle, if you remember, it made international news. I think that's why he was one of the last men to come up. Just saying. I never claimed to be a rocket scientist, but every single miner survived. But they survived because they had help from above. And you know what? Without help from above, there was no hope for those men. And I would propose to you that the same thing is true in our 21st century world. Without hope from above, there is no hope. like those miners, we need somebody up there to help us down here. And we go through different seasons of life. We go through seasons of life where the sun is shining and everything's good and all your kids are doing well and your job is good and your finances are good. Well, I don't ever go through seasons of life like that, but some of you might. I have this thing called consider it all joy, my brother, when you encounter various trials. But I go through other seasons, which I have walked through recently, where it's dark like a mine. And you don't see the sun. You know he's there. But you don't always feel him. You wonder if you're hearing his voice, and you know you do. He said you would, but sometimes it's dark. Usually every year I ask the Lord to give me one word for that year. I've done this for a long time. Give me a word just to pray about and focus on this year, and I didn't even ask God yet. But last November, I was sitting on that front row, obviously before everything went upside down in my life, and I was sitting on the front row, and I just heard God so clearly speak to me, your word for 2017 is hope. Little did I know what the close of 2016 would bring. Hope. Hope helped those miners. The family camp was called Camp Hope. A miner named his daughter Hope because, see, there's something about hope that sustains us, that strengthens us, that helps us to continue. In fact, the Bible says that hope is the anchor of our soul. It anchors our soul. And just consider for a moment, what's the purpose of an anchor on a ship? It's to keep the vessel from drifting and to provide a means of stability during a storm. Do you know that without hope, it is so easy to drift away from God, to drift away from his word, to drift away from church, to drift away from your spouse, to drift away from joy. Without hope, it's easy to drift away from peace and the giver of peace, the Prince of Peace. Without an anchor, we drift. We can drift away from our purpose or our calling. People who lose hope drift. And in a storm, people who lose hope, their life becomes like a ship that's just tossed this way and that way in a storm because there is no anchor to keep the rock and the pitch and the roll of life from just tossing you this way and that way. Hope offers stability even in a storm. And yet the enemy wants to steal our hope if he can. So finally, read with me Romans 15. I meant to look up if this is one of the verses we picked to memorize. I think it is, but if it's not, maybe it's one you do on your own. I memorized it as a child. Romans 15, 13, now may the God of hope, I'm reading from the New American Standard, now may the God of hope fill you. Do you see that? It's the God of hope. It's like God is identifying himself as part of his personality, his attributes. Part of who he is as God is that he's the God of hope. Now may the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace in believing so that you will abound in hope, not just have a little. Abound in hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. Look at this from the New Living. It says, I pray that God, the source of your hope, who's the source of our hope? God, the source of our hope, will fill you completely with joy and peace because you trust in him. Then you will overflow with confident hope through the power of the Holy Spirit. See, I want you to see this. There is something about trusting in God and being filled with hope that are married. They go together. They're joined. Trusting in God and being filled with hope are inseparable. And when our trust in God begins to falter, then hope begins to fade. When you lose one, you lose the other. But think about the word hope. How would you define it? Is it wishful thinking? Is it having an expectation? Is it having a positive attitude? Is it optimism? Some people would call hope optimism or say they're synonyms, but they are not the same thing. Optimism is telling yourself that things are going to be great even when they're not great. It's little orphan Annie singing, "The sun will come out tomorrow, bet your bottom dollar that tomorrow there'll be sun." And the sun does come out, but sometimes it hides behind the clouds and the storm rages. See, there's nothing wrong with optimism. I love optimistic people. I love to be around positive people much more than negative people. I like optimistic people versus pessimistic people. I think we all do. But the truth is that optimism, don't confuse optimism with hope, because optimism is not always in touch with reality. And it can be false hope. You're trying to convince yourself that something is true when you know in your heart it's not true. For example, I love football. I love the Broncos. And I can hope all I want to, and I put hope in quotes, all I want to, that something really bizarre and crazy will happen in the next 7 days, and my Broncos will actually end up playing in the Super Bowl again this year. And I can hope, and I can hope, and I can hope, but it's not going to happen. In fact, John, forgive me, one of my least favorite teams is playing in the Super Bowl this year. And I am... And I'm going to watch the Super Bowl anyway. But you know, if I hope that the Broncos are still going to be in the Super Bowl, you'll laugh at me, because we all know that's false hope, and that we can have false hope that's much less. We can get fooled. See, true, genuine hope does not take a vacation from reality. Optimism says it's not as bad as you think. Everything's going to be okay. Hope doesn't say that. Hope says it's bad. It's really, really bad. Everything may not be okay. And see, optimism can collapse under truth because it can be based on false projections. Hope, on the other hand, true hope, will never collapse because it's based on trusting in Almighty God. And that my God is greater and my God is stronger, and in the good times and the bad, he's still on the throne, and I can walk through really hard, terrible, horrible situations, and I can still trust him because I know he loves me, I know he's watching over me, and he will walk through the valley of the shadow of death with me, and I will trust him through it. And he's going to make me brave. And he's going to walk with me. I'm never alone. He will personally go before me. Deuteronomy 8:31, right? I have 31:8. I have 9:31 in my notes, and I knew that wasn't right. I have memorized this, but I understand if you don't believe me. True hope declares, "My God sovereign. He knows what he's doing, and I will trust him." See, true hope and trusting in God are inseparable. Psalm 20, just give me a couple more minutes. "Some trust in chariots and some in horses," but make this declaration. "Some trust in money, some trust in success, some trust in a good personality, some trust in the way they look, some people trust in a good stock portfolio." I don't know anything about that. "Some people trust in good friendships, some people," you put your what in there. "Some trust in chariots and horses." That was the words for that day. We have different words today. "Some trust in whatever, but I will," say it with me, "I will trust in the name of the Lord my God." See, please hear me on this. The reason I told you that story about the miners is because true hope says that someone up there will help me down here. And that's trusting in God. Proverbs 13:12 says, "Hope deferred makes the heart sick." Hope that's unfulfilled makes the heart sick. And so you have to say, "God, will you give me a new infusion of hope?" You know, in the book of Job, One of Job's friends gave a speech. Now, the book of Job, from my understanding of scripture, happened way at the beginning of time, like Job, Genesis area. Chronologically, Job was an early book. But in that beginning of creation time, one of Job's friends gives a speech with what is wrong with their world today. And I have heard a lot of speeches recently about what is wrong with our world today. Have you? The questions haven't changed, even though millenniums have passed. I've seen marches and demonstrations from people who may or may not disagree with, I may or may not disagree with them. I'm glad they have the right to share their opinion. I'm glad we live in a free nation. Let me just say this. It's been a tense election season, and whether you're happy with the results or not, our hope does not depend on the man who we put in the White House. Our hope depends on the man we put on the cross. Amen? So again, Job's friend gives a speech about what's wrong with his world, and he says this, "Those who forget God have no hope." Is that truth? That's truth. Those who forget God and have no hope, this is what he goes on to say. They are like rushes, and I don't exactly know what this means, but they are rushes without any mire to grow in. So we'll just say they are like petunias with nowhere to grow, or grass without water to keep it alive. And suddenly it begins to wither even before it is cut. Man without God is trusting in a spider's web. Everything he counts on will collapse. But the section begins with those who forget God have no hope. Do you know the further you get away from God, the less hope you have? But the flip is true. The closer you get to God, the more hope you have. See, real hope is not based on my wishes or my dreams. It's not based on a name it or claim it, name it and claim it theology. Real hope is not based on what I sense. I wish this would happen. Real hope is not based on I think I can make this happen. Real hope is based on one thing. I will trust God no matter what. And he's working, and someone from above is working on what I'm at down here. And it may not come as quickly as I want. It sure didn't for those miners. But it came, and it will come for us. Do you know that in his word, God has given us about 7,000 promises. See, real hope is based on what God has said, not what I'm feeling. Real hope is not based on my emotion, but what God has spoken. Real hope is not based on my imagination, but on God's obligation to do what he said he would do. Again, he's given us 7,000 promises in his word. And over again, the Bible says God cannot lie. He will be faithful to his word. God is truth. His word is truth. And when we put our hope in his promises and we trust him to fulfill them, then our hope is real and enduring and sustaining and unshakable. And it's an anchor for our souls. You know, we can live through mind-trapped experiences and know that there is someone up there helping us down here because we have a Savior and a Redeemer named Jesus, and we trust in him, and we have hope in him that cannot be stolen. I wrote this. Hope is not an emotion. Rather, it is the conviction that God will be faithful to his word, to his promises, regardless of my circumstances or my feelings. My hope is real because my God is real and I will trust him. Amen and amen and amen. So how I want us to close this morning, if the worship team will come up here. I want us to pray that God would infuse us with a new infusion of hope, that God would inject us with just a new injection of hope. You know, quite a few people came up after first service and they just wanted us to pray for them, that God would give them hope in this circumstance or that situation. And I would encourage you to do that again. If you've lost your hope in something, ask God to give you new hope. Will you stand with me? I also want us to pray that God would give us hope as a church family, that God would infuse and inject hope into us as a corporate body. First service and second service together. I want us to pray that God would infuse hope into our country. There are a lot of hopeless people in our country. that God would infuse hope, that God is God. He's on the throne and we can trust him. So you just pray with me. God, would you just pray for yourself? Would you, God, would you just give me a new infusion of hope? God, in this area of my life, in that area of my life, in this relationship, in this job situation, whatever it is, in my health. Joanne, God wants to infuse in you new hope in your health. He saved you for a reason, and it wasn't to have you live in pain all the rest of your days. So, Father, we call forth hope for Joanne. We thank you again and again for saving her life, but I just pray hope would be infused into her. Will you pray hope for our church? Father, we've asked you for a new building, and it seems like every door we've asked you to open, you've closed. And we just trust you in that. But we just call forth hope in that area, Lord. Your word to us a number of years ago was that you already had your hand on a new building for us. And so, Father, we just cling to that word. We say, be it unto us according to your word, like Mary said of old. Father, as a corporate body, would you infuse hope? And Father, as a nation, would you infuse hope in our nation? In spite of the crisis, in spite of the disagreements, in spite of the turmoil and the strife, Lord, would you infuse hope? And would you have people stop looking at each other and accusing each other and start looking up? Instead of looking at the dense forest, would you have them look up at the sun? Would you bring revival to our nation, Lord? That's what's going to bring hope to our nation. Bring revival to our nation. I don't know where you're at, but if you need hope, would you just keep praying for yourself while we sing this song? Pray hope over your kids. Pray hope over your grandkids. Hope deferred makes the heart sick. Father, break off any hope deferred in this place.
Be still. There is a healer. His love is deeper than the sea.